know more such amazing stories from Indian history, click the bell icon and subscribe to Live History India. Indira Gandhi may have looked confident when she took oath as the Prime Minister on 24 January 1966, but she was far from it. Naturally shy and nervous by temperament, she was also a lightweight within the Congress, even though she was Jawaharlal Nehru's daughter. She had been President of the Indian National Congress in 1959 and the Information and Broadcasting Minister in the brief Shastri government, yet Indira was tentative about her place in the world and her ideological moorings. Indira Gandhi was only 48 when she became Prime Minister, but in a matter of just 3 years, she underwent a stunning metamorphosis. She took on the Congress chieftains known as the Syndicate, who were instrumental in making her Prime Minister, and made them bite the dust. The Syndicate, with veteran leader Kumaraswamy Kamaraj of Tamil Nadu as its most prominent leader, was formed in 1963. S. Nijalingappa of Mysore, now Karnataka, Neelam Sanjeeva Reddy of Andhra Pradesh, Atulya Ghosh of West Bengal and S. K. Patil of Maharashtra were its other prominent members. The Syndicate chose Indira Gandhi as Prime Minister for three reasons. First, they felt she was young, inexperienced and pliable. Second, the Syndicate was against Morarji Desai becoming Prime Minister. Rigid and conservative, Desai had a mind of his own. Lastly, the Syndicate felt that with no mass leader in the Congress after Nehru, Indira Gandhi would galvanize voters in the 1967 general elections. In a nutshell, she was to be a puppet, famously and frequently heckled as a goongi gudiya or a dumb doll. But her critics couldn't be more wrong. Indira Gandhi's first major differences with the Syndicate arose on the issue of the devaluation of the rupee. Indira Gandhi had taken this step as the 1965 India-Pakistan war and two consecutive droughts had drained the economy and the country's balance of payment situation was precarious after the US put the aid on hold. Congress President Kamaraj felt slighted and he openly criticized the devaluation as Indira Gandhi had not consulted him on the matter. The Syndicate slowly sensed that the frail-looking Indira Gandhi possessed a unique trait of taking tough decisions even at the cost of antagonizing senior party colleagues. That's when they began plotting to overthrow her. But before the Syndicate could move against her, Kamaraj, Patil and Ghosh lost the 1967 elections. The election also provided a glimpse into Indira Gandhi's emergence as a mass leader. Although the Congress had scraped through with a thin majority, winning 283 of the 520 seats and losing election in 7 state assemblies, Indira Gandhi was the biggest draw for the party. But her emerging charisma made the Syndicate increasingly uncomfortable. Their simmering differences came to a head when country's president Dr. Zakir Hussain died in May 1969. Ignoring Indira Gandhi's opposition, the Syndicate chose Neelam Sanjeeva Reddy as the Congress's presidential candidate. Indira was now convinced that the Syndicate would attempt to dislodge her if Reddy became the President of India. Joining the fight, Indira took away the finance portfolio from Morarji Desai. He had been a stumbling block in the implementation of her radical economic programs, most importantly, the nationalization of banks and the abolition of privy purses. In July 1969, Gandhi had nationalized 14 banks, taking the fight to the Syndicate. Her decision galvanized Congress MPs. With those of the left of the center standing by her, the left-right schism in the party became wider. Next, Indira went against the Congress party's decision during the presidential elections in August 1969. She supported Vice President V.V. Giri, an independent candidate, against the official party nominee Neelam Sanjeeva Reddy. She appealed to the Congress MPs to vote according to their conscience. Giri defeated Reddy to become the President of India. Humiliated by the defeat, Congress President Nijalingappa expelled Indira Gandhi from the party on grounds of indiscipline on the 12th of November 1969. As a result, the Congress split, with Indira Gandhi heading the Congress R faction and the syndicate forming the Congress O. Indira kept her position as Prime Minister with the support of the Communists and other parties, but it was a minority government. The Bank Nationalisation and the Privy Purses Act were struck down by the Supreme Court. However, confident that her economic programs had struck a chord among the people, Indira Gandhi then fired a powerful salvo. She called for a midterm poll in March 1971. Riding on the wave of Garibi Hatao or Remove Poverty slogan, Indira returned to power with 352 seats in the 1971 elections. The Congress O, led by syndicate members, won just 16. The verdict couldn't have been clearer. During the election campaign, a Newsweek reporter had asked her to comment on the main issues during the polls. "I am the issue," she asserted. Indira Gandhi had risen in a new avatar. The young Indira had lived in the shadow of two dominating men, her father Jawaharlal Nehru and husband Firoz Gandhi. As a young Prime Minister, she was taunted by socialist stalwart Ram Manohar Lohia as a Gungi Gudiya or a dumb doll. Morarji Desai often referred to her as a chit of a girl. Her metamorphosis from a Gungi Gudiya to a mass leader was spectacular and dramatic. Her fight she had led and fought in the first 5 years of her tenure also set a tone for what was to come.